Good afternoon. Welcome to the Empire Series. My name is Arthur Lupia, and I'm the MPSA president. I'm thrilled that you're here, both supporting the organization and being at the conference, and helping us try this new endeavor called the Empire Series. It's really an attempt to provide value to the membership by showing you some great ideas and some great talks all in the same room, giving you the chance to ask questions, and so forth. So it's a nice opportunity. At the end, I'll ask you what you think of it and things like that, but we want to know if this is something you'd like to see more of at the Midwest. It's my great pleasure today to introduce to you John Hibbing. John Hibbing is the Foundation Regents University Professor at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln. Working primarily with Kevin B. Smith of UNL and John Alford of Rice University. All right, there you go. Hibbing's current research interests center on the relationship of biological characteristics to political orientations and behavior. Deep individual differences exist across humans, and he studies the manner in which these biological variations mitigate the way in which individuals respond to politically relevant environmental occurrences. He's most proud of being in the Dana College Athletic Hall of Fame, having an article in Science, co-authoring with his son Matthew, receiving a Guggenheim Fellowship, and creating a course for undergraduates entitled Genes, Brains, and Politics. In today's talk, entitled Bedrock Differences Between Liberals and Conservatives, he makes the case that the burgeoning research on the biological and deep psychological bases of political orientations could lead to greater political tolerance. It's my great pleasure to introduce to you Professor John Hibbing.
Political conflict is all too common. Without breaking a sweat, I pulled down images here of some very violent protests that took place surrounding the World Trade Organization meetings. Equally violent protests that followed the announcement in France by the Hollande administration that they were liberalizing attitudes and policies toward same-sex marriage and same-sex adoption, making some other changes in traditional family arrangements. In the bottom left, we have protests that took place in response to the Taliban's attempted assassination of Malala, who had the temerity to advocate for women and girls going to school. And then, of course, the blowing up of the federal building in Oklahoma City because of attitudes that were extremely hostile toward an activist government. I think what's interesting about all these cases is that they involve ideas. Certainly the instances, the current situation in Crimea suggests that border disputes are not going away, but increasingly, and in direct contrast to the end of ideology school of thought, we see violent conflicts over ideas and ideologies and attitudes, whether it be same-sex marriage or girls going to school. And it doesn't have to be violence. I mean, political conflict is a source of deadlock in legislatures, strife in family reunions. It's everywhere. And I wish I could tell you that in the next 25 to 30 minutes I was going to end political conflict. I don't think I can do that. But I honestly do believe that I have some ideas that could help around the edges. That might mitigate political conflict to a certain extent. But in order to do that, we need to change the way we view the human condition as scholars and as human beings. So here's a way, it turns out this doesn't come through real well, but I think I can talk you through it. I think this is not an unfair portrayal of the way political scientists and most humans usually view the human condition. So we start off on the far left there with some early life events, primarily parental socialization. Then we move into adult years, and basically we can define who we are politically by knowing something about sociodemographics. Are you male? Are you female? Are you young? Are you old? Are you rich? Are you poor? Are you educated or not? And also the overt political issues and experiences that you've had. And if you look at most of our articles, whether we call them control variables or explanatory variables, this is usually what we focus on, sociodemographic kinds of things and overt political experiences. This is what I call the thin conception of the human condition, because there really isn't a lot there. If we know those things, we pretty much know what you need to know. So that's a thin bar, and these life events that we have during the course of our lives as adults funnel through fairly directly into political beliefs and actions. So as a result of that, you see the shading here is supposed to indicate whether who we are politically has changed at all. So that first life event changed us for a little bit, turned it light, but then it went back to dark. The middle one had a more long-lasting effect on us. Not only did it affect the political beliefs and actions that we see in the arrow at the bottom, but it also changed that coloration for quite a long period of time. And I think this is part and parcel of this traditional view of the human condition with regard to politics, that events can change things. This is what we study as political scientists for the most part. We love to study the effects of 9/11, or if there's nothing in the environment that really had an effect we're interested in, we create one in the laboratory. We think change happens a lot. Well, I'd like to suggest that we need to alter that view of the human condition just a little bit. And now we see that rectangle has become much larger. This is a thicker version, thicker vision of the human condition. You'll notice on the left, not only do we have early life events, which, by the way, are still there. Some people who read our work have the impression that we're trying to substitute other things for socialization, and that's certainly not the case. Early life events such as socialization are still very important, but you'll see we are adding two very important variables, early development and genetics. These things affect who we are politically as well. Genetics gets a lot of attention, perhaps too much attention, and I think if that's something that bothers you with regard to this, if it's something that bothers you, you could ignore that for the purposes of this talk. It's just not that central. But I think it's silly to believe that genetics are not involved with politics, just as it's involved with pretty much everything else about us. Early development is really quite interesting and doesn't get much attention. I'll give you one quick example that I think is fascinating. You know, most monozygotic twins are born in the same chorion, the outer birth sac. But about one-third of monozygotic twins are born in separate chorions. So now this has nothing to do with genetics. This is developmental. These are identical twins, so they're equally similar in terms of genetic heritage. But they're in the same womb at the same time. But in one case, they're in the same chorion. In another case, they're in separate chorions. Well, the studies haven't been done about politics, but they've been done about a lot of other things. And it turns out that dichorionic monozygotic twins are much less similar than monochorionic monozygotic twins. And that, to me, is really fascinating and indicative of the power of something like early development. So whether it's prenatal development or other very early development, whether it's genetics, early life experiences, these things all come together and form who we are as adult human beings with regard to politics. We like to think of who we are in terms of politics as predispositions. And this concept has gone by lots of other phrases, and I think it's very similar. Some people call them antecedent conditions. Some people call it motivated social reasoning, motivated social cognition, automaticity. So, you know, whatever your phrase, I don't care. We like predispositions, but it doesn't have to be that. But the idea is that these things are very individual. It's not enough to know who you are in terms of your socio-demographics and your overt political experiences, but we need to know a lot more about you. And because these individual experiences, individual traits are changeable, but they're very inertial. I think of them like super tankers. It takes a lot to change who we are politically and in terms of personality and lots of other things as well. So these are characteristics that are embedded in our physiology, in the way we process things and what we pay attention to, in our neural patterns, and also in very broad psychological kinds of things. So this is what I mean by a thicker conception of the human conditions. It's not just socio-demographics and overt political experiences. Maybe this helps a little bit more. Here we kind of superimpose that previous conception, the socio-demographics and overt political experiences, but you'll see that's just one part of it. What else is there? Well, there are conscious predispositions that are not overtly political. And here I'm thinking especially maybe of the good research that's been done recently on personality traits. So it's not overtly political, whether you're an extrovert or an introvert, but scholars like Jeff Mondak, Alan Gerber, Caprera, and others have indicated recently that these kinds of personality traits are really important with regard to politics. But people are conscious of them. You know, if you ask people, in fact, that's usually how personality traits are measured. There's a self-report battery that taps the big five that says, you know, are you an extrovert, an introvert? Are you agreeable or not? So that's one example of a conscious predisposition that's not overt political. But then also, very importantly, there are non-conscious predispositions. So these are things that we're simply not aware of. And this really changes the game pretty dramatically in terms of how we understand the human condition and how we study it. So this means that self-reports, as important as they are probably not going to be all that we need to use. People are not aware of what has influenced them politically. They're not aware of who they are politically. Now, these aren't drawn to scale. I don't know if that's 50% or more or less, but at least gives you the idea that we need to go beyond the standard control variables of sociodemographics and overt politics. So because of this thicker conception of the human condition, that means some of these life events are not going to really trickle through into political beliefs and actions. They just get swallowed up by this very elaborate set of predispositions that we have. A lot of times they move on through, and certainly they can affect not just a political action and behavior. You know, we respond to a speech that was given by President Obama in a certain way, but maybe that's affected who we are politically, at least for a short period of time, and that's what this kind of brief glow, brief change in coloration would indicate. I hesitated to put up this next one because I don't think it happens very often. So here, a life event has not only affected a political belief and action, but it's really had a fairly permanent change. It looks like the fading is, or the light coloration is fading out toward the end. But nonetheless, this was a fairly sustained change in our predispositions. And I wanted to emphasize that, in my view, this doesn't happen all that often. I mean, we all know people who have done a political 180, but they aren't that common. I think the fact that we remember them is indicative of the fact that that's really fairly unusual. These predispositions are difficult to change, and they usually don't change. Sometimes when it appears that they have, it's because people have not really solidified their initial position, and they think they've changed, but maybe they're still in their early 20s, and they were still sorting things out. So in this conception, change is not as ready as in the traditional view that I think political scientists and a lot of ordinary citizens have. So what happens is, because I kind of think of the human condition as a prism, with an N, not an O-N, it bends the light, it bends these events, and it bends them in different ways. So here we see a life event affecting things and leading to political belief A. Here we see it bending in a different way and leading to political belief B. So it's the same life event, but because the person experiencing them had such different predispositions, such different conscious and non-conscious awareness, that it led to really quite a different action or quite a different set of attitudes. All right, I think we need an example. That's all very very abstract. So let me give an example of a way that things that aren't overtly political and that are sometimes non-conscious can affect political attitudes. It is possible to measure disgust sensitivity. Well, actually, let me back up one second. I like disgust because it does have a conscious component, it's got a non-conscious component, and because in some views, I'm thinking especially of the neuroscientist John Allman, he believes that everything revolves around a lust-disgust spectrum. That you can go back to the very earliest single-cellular life. Actually, not quite the very earliest, because there would have to be some motility here, but as soon as cells were able to move, they would move toward things that they lusted for, things, a pleasant environment, something where they could get nutrients, and they moved away from things that disgusted them. And Allman sees this as really being fundamental. You might argue about whether that's really lust and disgust, but I think it's an interesting concept, that this is really about as basic as it can get. So for several reasons, I think disgust is a good illustration for us here today. So it is possible to measure disgust with survey batteries. In fact, there are several famous ones. One that's used most widely is called the DSR, Disgust Sensitivity Revised. There are 25 items. I've put two items up here to give you an illustration. So people just answer these the way we're used to, whether you strongly agree with this, agree but not strongly, kind of in the middle, disagree or strongly disagree. So here are the items. Even if I was hungry, I would not drink a bowl of my favorite soup if it had been stirred by a used but thoroughly washed fly swatter. Item number two, it would bother me to sleep in a nice hotel room if I knew that a man had died of a heart attack in that room the night before. So as I said, there are 25 of these items. 5-point scale, you can run it all out, and you get a nice set of variations. Some people, it turns out, are extremely disgust sensitive. These things would bother them a lot. They definitely disagree that they would eat a bowl of soup that had been stirred by a fly swatter. Other people are quite different. All right, well, it turns out that there is a political correlate of these things. If you add up people's responses to the disgust sensitivity battery and then correlate that with a very simple question about their political ideology, which ranges from very liberal to moderate, all the way to very conservative, you get a pretty nice correlation, about 0.2. Again, there's plenty of opportunity for variance here. If you report yourself to be highly disgust sensitive, but you're very liberal, don't worry. You got plenty of company. Lots of people are like that. 0.2 is what it is. So it's there. It's definitely significant. This has been replicated in lots of studies in lots of different countries. So it appears as though there is a correlation between your sensitivity to disgusting items, as reported by yourself, and the degree to which you are politically conservative. Well, that's nice, and that's an illustration of how we've moved now beyond that little band of overt politics, because disgust is really more than that. You wouldn't say that's overtly political, but it's related to politics, but it's still on the conscious side of the ledger. Let's move down to the non-conscious and see if there's a correlation between people's non-conscious response to disgusting things and their political beliefs. This is the work that we've done using electrodermal response, which, as many of you know, is perhaps the most widely used and certainly the most accepted way of measuring people's sympathetic nervous system response. So if something's arousing you, whether it's positive or negative, and you think your body believes that there might be need for action, probably you're going to have some sweat glands open up just a little bit, eccrine glands, which maybe will cool you down if things get really intense. Whether the intensity is positive, you have to run away, or run towards somebody and give them a hug because it's a loved one, or if you see a bear and you need to run away. So you put a couple of sensors on people's fingers, put a little gel on them, pipe some electricity across there. We all know that electricity moves more rapidly if there's some moisture present, since resistance goes down. And that's really all those sensors are picking up, whether or not there's moisture. It's not moisture to the touch. Some people think you have to have clammy hands. That's not true. They're very sensitive. So it can be identical to the touch, but there can be a big change in the readings that we obtain with these physiological sensors. So then you show people disgusting images, such as a guy eating worms. And I'm very proud of this picture, because if you look carefully, you'll see that's not just any guy eating worms, but I am the person eating worms in this case. And the reason I'm eating worms here is because we did use an actual picture of a person eating worms, but it was part of the International Affective Pictorial System, which they don't like you to put in any media accounts. So we were getting some requests for examples of the stimuli we were used that were disgusting. We couldn't use the IOPS pictures, so we thought it would be a good idea to have a stimulated one that was copyrighted by us. I thought that graduate students would be the appropriate parties to have these things done, but none of my graduate students would step forward to do this. So I did, and more importantly, my wife Anne was willing to take this picture, and I can vouch that she is quite disgust sensitive after that. And now, since I went to all that work, every presentation I give, I show this picture. I just have to. But the larger point is, we show them disgusting images like that, and then we correlated that with the same kind of thing, a liberal conservative self-report. And we get a nice correlation too. In fact, just a little bit stronger than what Inbar and his colleagues obtained doing the self-report procedure. This holds up. Since we've got a lot of political scientists here, we need to think about controls. So we can control for gender, age, education. We also control the SR refers to self-report. So this would be the disgust sensitivity battery that I mentioned before. So it's, even when that's included in the model, we partial that out, we're still getting a pretty strong correlation between physiological. So again, nobody's asking people anything here. We're just showing them these images, such as a guy eating worms, observing the extent to which their electrodermal response increases. And it occurred to me after, this morning when I was thinking about this talk, I should have had a couple of slides of what happens in the physiology. When you show somebody an image that's evocative, it'll stay the same, and then about a second or two later, you see a blip up, and then it stays up for a while, starts to move back down. Usually what we use is something called area under the curve. So some people use just the change, the distance to the highest amplitude, but it's nice, I think, to know how long it stays high rather than just how high it went. So you can do that with area under the curve. So this is just a measure of the physiological response, the degree to which somebody is responsive to disgusting images. And it does appear that conservatives not just say they're more responsive to disgusting images, but they also physiologically respond that way. But we're political scientists, and we know that this liberal conservative self-report covers a lot of ground. There are all kinds of different issues that could be involved. So we asked people specific questions about their issue positions. And then we found something that I think is pretty interesting. As you can see here, I hope it comes through, most of the issues don't have any relationship at all with physiological response to disgusting things. But what does is attitudes toward gay marriage. Now, it's a little bit misleading because there were a couple of other issues, but mostly sexually related issues that did generate a positive response. Certainly economic kinds of issues did not seem to be strongly related. So, libertarians are not more disgust sensitive than liberals. But social conservatives, especially social conservatives in the area of sexual kinds of things, and particularly gay marriage, that's where we saw a really strong relationship between disgust sensitivity. And again, these are not people who say, gay marriage or the concept of gay sex is disgusting. This is general disgust toward things that have nothing to do with sexuality directly. This too holds up quite strongly. You know, it bounces around. Some of the relationships are we've got about as many negative relationships as positive, but none of them are really very close to significance except those having to do with sexuality and particularly gay marriage. What I think is kind of interesting then is we're getting a strong relationship both for the self-report, so that the conscious idea is still relevant. It's not like physiology is the real deal. In fact, you got to get away from this idea that something is your real response to disgust. I think both your vision of yourself, how disgust sensitive you are, and your physiological reaction to disgusting things, they're both important, as is indicated here, both strongly related to an issue such as opposition to gay marriage. What I think makes this really interesting is they're not related to each other. You might think that would make sense, that people who said, oh yeah, you know, the prospect of drinking soup that had been stirred by a fly swatter really bothers me, those would be the ones who would have the strongest physiological response to disgusting images. And that's just not the case. So this, I think, makes a pretty strong case for the fact that we do need to include both. You know, a lot of people, I've seen it in many reviews that we've received, say things like, well, you know, why do we need to go all this trouble? Won't we just get the same thing by the self-report? And you know, I think in many cases you don't, because people aren't fully aware of how they're responding to these kinds of things. But you know, note again that self-report does not go away once we include physiology. So no danger that we should wrap up the ANES and get rid of it. It's crucial. But it is not the only game in town. Another reason, I think, or another illustration of why I think it's useful to do both the physiology and the self-report is revealed by a gender breakdown here. So I showed you a little study by Inbar before. He and others have come to conclusions like this. Females are more disgust sensitive than males. And I think adding the physiology suggests that we need to be a little bit careful of conclusions like that. So on the left, again, SR is self-report, so that's the disgust sensitivity battery where people are answering questions. And then you see, sure enough, that females report to be much more disgust sensitive than males. But on the right two bars, you see another female-male breakdown. But there, that's the physiological response. And there you see that it's exactly the same. And I think that's kind of interesting. And by the way, those are standardized, so it's not the case that females are over-reporting. We can't draw that conclusion. In fact, it looks like females are over-reporting, if you use the baseline as the physiological response, and males are under-reporting. And I think this fits with our cultural notions of you know, kind of what people are encouraged to be. In fact, whenever I present this slide, I have this image of a male saying something like, you know, not only would I eat a bowl of soup that had been stirred by a fly swatter, but that's the only way I eat my soup. So there's this notion, you know, that males need to be tough and impervious to all these things, and perhaps there's also pressure on females to be, you know, to present themselves as being extremely sensitive. So, you know, I think here again we see the usefulness, I believe, of a physiological response, because if you look at that, there just is no difference at all in how they respond. Let's broaden this out just a little bit from disgust and think of images that are negative more generally. And you know, some people might view this as a disgusting image, but it's more than that. I'm not sure what it is, but it's certainly negative, and therefore we'd like to know how people are responding to it. We also added positive images, so it wasn't just looking at negative, but we showed positive images, and this is the kind of image that tends to rate very highly. One of the nice things about using those IOPS pictures I mentioned before is that they've been pre-rated, so we know which images generally are favorable to people. This one's favorable. The previous one is unfavorable, so we had a long set of images that were negative, a long set that were positive, and some that were neutral. We got an interesting finding here, I think. We broke people down according to whether they're liberal or conservative. And this, by the way, was liberal-conservative on the basis of their issue positions. So I'm really not a big fan of the self-report single-item thing. So we added up their positions on a lot of issues that are traditionally viewed to be liberal or conservative. And so high scores here were conservative. And what we see, the blue solid line is for those who were on the liberal half of this issue battery. And what's interesting is, first of all, psychologists tend to use words like aversive and appetitive rather than negative and positive, but it means the same thing. What you see is that liberals are pretty much responding physiologically about the same to positive images as to negative images. Maybe just a little bit more for aversive, but that's not statistically significant. But look at conservatives, the dotted line, and there you see a really sharp drop-off between negative to positive images. So physiologically speaking, conservatives are responding much more strongly to the images of the house on fire, the guy eating worms, than they are to images of fruit displays, attractive foodstuffs, people having a good time like the individual was skiing, things like that. Here's another way of looking at it. We showed them about, I think in this case, 36, 37 images, some positive, some negative. So we just recorded which were the three top images in terms of increasing physiological response for liberals and for conservatives. And I think the difference is really instructive. So those are the three images that were the highest for liberals. What really increased their physiology was a happy kid, an interracial kiss, and there's the fruit display. And then look at conservatives. Here are the three images that evoked the largest physiological response for them. A physical altercation, an argument. I don't know how well you can see that, but there are two people really arguing. And then a spider on the face. So, you know, I think that just indicates the kind of differences that we have, the kind of richness that we need to be focused on in this thicker conception of the human condition than just sociodemographics. Continuing with this example, let's shift from physiology just a little bit to cognition, or at least to what people pay attention to. And this is what you can do with an eye tracker. And some of you may be familiar with eye trackers because they're used frequently for web design to know where to put the trackers or the tickers and where people are going to focus their attention. They also have a very useful application in academia because it helps us to understand what people are paying attention to. So instead of looking at one image at a time, we created these collages of images where we had a different image in each of the four quadrants of the screen. And then we'd start people off and see what they were going to look at. So here we have an instance where three images rated very positively and one rated negatively. I think you can probably figure out which would be which in this case. Here's another example. This one goes the other way. Three negative images and one positive image. The beach ball is rated positively and those other three aren't. In fact, if you look at what people pay attention to, and again, divide it down by liberals and conservatives in the same fashion I did before, you see that everybody has a bit of a negativity bias, and this has been widely known among psychologists for a long, long time. People generally respond more physiologically to negative things, and they pay more attention to negative things. Presumably, there's a very logical evolutionary reason for this. But what's interesting is, even though that's a fairly basic human tendency, that doesn't mean it's the same for all of us. So when we break it down by liberals and conservatives, we see that liberals do, the fact that that line, the blue line is positive, indicates that liberals do have a negativity bias, but it's not a very big one. It's about 400 milliseconds, 4/10 of a second, in an 8-second free view task. Conservatives, on the other hand, spend about 1.6 seconds longer on the negative items. And that difference of 1.2 seconds in an 8-second free view may not seem like much, but whenever we've shown this to eye tracking specialists, they've said this is a lot. In fact, one of them referred to it as an eternity. So that was good enough for us. There really is quite a difference in the extent to which liberals and conservatives pay attention to positive and negative things. Now, if I can get this to work, I was going to show you one example. This is a subject, an actual subject who was spending 8 seconds looking at this. And given what I just told you, you should be able to tell me whether or not this person is a liberal or a conservative. So there's our 8 seconds. And if you notice, they didn't spend a lot of time looking at the beach ball. They didn't show at all?
No.
Oh, it looked great on my screen. It was beautiful. All right, well, we've been having trouble with this throughout. So now we have a disconnect between what I'm seeing and what's up there. We should have given up on that video clip from the very beginning. It just wasn't going to happen. And it's not that crucial. You can pretty much imagine. They're just two dots. They move around, you know, where the guy's looking. This individual spent most of the time looking at the car. I think he must be a body shop worker, I'm convinced. But there was definitely not much time spent on the positive image. So the bottom line is that there appears to be a difference in negativity bias between liberals and conservatives. Interesting. I think more work needs to be done on sorting out exactly which issues might be pertinent here, liberal and conservative on what issues, but certainly with regard to social issues, there's a difference in negativity bias. Some people think liberals look at the world through rose-colored glasses. Some people think conservatives look at the world through fear goggles, a phrase that John Stewart used the other night. And I have a picture of rose-colored glasses and fear goggles. But now we're looking at the world through very dark goggles right now. So, yes, the negativity bias. And, you know, here's where things get sticky, and I'm going to start to bring it back now to my initial point about political conflict and why changing our perception of the human condition might be able to help with regard to this. So both rose-colored glasses and fear goggles, I think, have a certain negative connotation, and I'm going to try to convince you that we need to recognize these differences without really making value judgments about them. It's very easy to say that, one of the favorite conservative lines, of course, is that liberals just don't get it. They don't understand that it's a dangerous world. And I think that's absolutely true in many respects. From the perspective of a conservative, liberals don't get it. But from the perspective of a liberal, there is nothing to get, or at least not nearly as much to get. From the perspective of a liberal, conservatives are finding, you know, boogeymen where there aren't any. And so who's right? You know, I don't think we can say. One of the things I was going to do, and I'm not even going to try right now, is there's a kind of a neat clip of Wayne LaPierre, the chief executive officer of the National Rifle Association. It's about a 25-second clip where he, this was to the CPAC meeting just last month. And for 25 seconds, he lists all the dangers that exist in the world. There are these kinds of killers, airport killers, video game killers. He just goes on and on and on. And at the end of the 25 seconds, you're about ready to just crawl in bed and pull the covers up. But the question is, you know, I think what we need to do, and when I say we, I'm thinking, you know, I'm speaking to a primarily liberal audience, is not have the sense that Wayne LaPierre is, you know, morally and intellectually bankrupt. And one of the things I liked about this clip that you're not going to see is that you could feel it. I mean, this was the way the world seemed to him. And I think what our research suggests is that people are like that. There really are these fundamental differences in how people physiologically respond to things and what they pay attention to. And, you know, you could say that, well, Wayne LaPierre is like that because he spent so much time in, you know, around people in the NRA. I don't really believe that. And that implies that if many of you were in the situation that Wayne LaPierre had been in for his adult life, you would be the same as he is. And I just don't believe that. I think we need to appreciate the extent to which there are these differences. And I think we need to make an effort to believe that those people who are different than we are not simply fundamentally evil. And it's not advancing. Okay. So here, we got no more video clips, so I think we should be clear sailing. So, you know, people can get pretty worked up about Dick Cheney. Some people get worked up about Barack Obama. But what I'm trying to convince you to do is to not assume automatically that your political opponents have moral failings or intellectual failings. They just experience the world differently. So to take a couple of examples of popular books, Ann Coulter on the right says that liberals definitely have an intellectual failing. If they had any brains, they wouldn't be liberals. They wouldn't be Democrats. They'd be Republicans. Al Franken believes people on the right have a moral failing. They're liars. They're lying liars who tell lies, as a matter of fact. So these kinds of books sell really well. As you can see, they're both, they say that national number one New York Times bestseller. Well, then there are books like this. And my condition for giving this talk, I told Skip, was that I had to have one shameless plug. And our publisher, Michael Kearns, is here, so he would have killed me if I didn't. But in all seriousness, you know, we make the pitch that we shouldn't just beat up on the other side. It's fun. And, you know, if you're famous and you just say lots of terrible things about the people on the other side of you politically, you're going to have a number one New York Times bestseller. If you're three workaday scholars struggling away, trying to make an honest point about how, you know, it's deeper than that, that people on the left and people on the right just view the world differently and experience the world differently, you know, you're probably not going to have a New York Times bestseller. But it's a book we're proud of, and we think it's a point worth making. It's not an easy thing to do. Very early on, when our research got a little bit of attention in the press, we had an email from a lady that I'll never forget. She said, "Don't do this to me. I need to hate conservatives." And we did what you did. We had a good laugh. And then, you know, I thought about it a bit, and I said, well, that's kind of sad in a way, but I think it's very true. But we need to ask ourselves, you know, when we're saying these horrible things about Dick Cheney or Barack Obama, whatever side you're on, You know, why are we doing this? Are we really trying to make the political system better? Or does this make us feel good? Or are we sending signals that, we're really one of this tribe, the appropriate group? And I don't think just hollering names or throwing these aspersions back and forth, as Coulter and Franken do, is really going to get us anywhere. If you think about it, throughout history, this recognition that there's a deep biological cognitive basis for traits has usually led to more tolerance. In the upper left, we've got somebody who's left-handed writing on this. And, you know, it used to be believed that left-handedness was because people had a bad habit or they were lazy. My father was left-handed, and he was hit, you know, in school with a ruler. He claimed until his hand was bleeding. You know, I never know about this, but still, that was the attitude. This is something needed to be beat out of people because it was just a habit. Now we know it's biological. We know it's so biological that when my colleagues and I do neuroimaging studies, we have to eliminate people who are left-handed or people who are right-handed. We can't have them mixed. You know, there's some very deep differences in the brain. This is biological. When that happens, people are now much more tolerant of left-handed people. We even have desks for them in my room, God. You know, it's ridiculous. mental illness. You know, it used to be that we thought this was something that people were possessed by the devil, it was evil, and now we recognize it's very biological. This has been a godsend for both the people who have mental disabilities and also for their parents, because it was believed, you know, as a refrigerator mother or a distant father. Now we know that it's much more than that. Tolerance has increased dramatically. Gay marriage is a classic example of this. There's a statistically consistent correlation between those people who believe that sexual orientation is biological and tolerance. People are much more tolerant of individuals when they believe it's not just something that's environmental, that we can send people to boot camp and drum it out of them. So tolerance goes along with the belief that there are these deep biological predispositions. And I think the same thing would happen with politics as well. Name-calling is counterproductive. And efforts at conversion. You know, I'm not saying here that you should no longer try to persuade people. A lot of people are persuadable. But you can usually identify those people who aren't. I'm flattering myself to think I'm pretty good at this now. When I start talking to somebody politically, I know when, you know, there's communication is really not going to be very fruitful. But there are a lot of people for whom it is. There are a lot of people who are not firmly predisposed one way or the other. The Carville-Madeline case, I think, is fascinating for me and for lots of political scientists. How can these people make it work? You know, politics is so important to us. The notion of living with somebody who just had such a different worldview is really pretty amazing. And I don't know if you've ever, you know, listened to any of the discussion that Carville and Madeline will have about their relationship. There's one I remember when somebody said, what's the three secrets to your marriage? How did you make it work? And Carville says, retreat, capitulation, and surrender. And Madeline says, that is so typically like a liberal. You know, grow a spine. And she says, my three are faith, family, and good wine, or something. But then the important point for us here is that they go on and they say, basically, we don't talk about politics at home. And they said, in fact, the two darkest times of our marriage, when things really got serious, was when we could not keep politics out of the home. It was during the Florida recount and during the Iraq war. And they said that politics was so pervasive in the world and in their lives that they couldn't keep it out and that this was really a bad thing for them. So, you know, I think there are times when communication, the deliberative Democrats are doing a lot of great things, but this notion that it's always good to talk about things, I just have never bought. And I think we need to be more careful in studying the situations under which discussion is useful and when it isn't. And when people really have predispositions that are fundamentally at odds with our own, it just won't do any good. So, last slide. I think by adjusting our conception of the human condition, really appreciating that these predispositions make us unique, that they're real, that they're long-lasting, they're difficult to change, they need to be studied. You know, I've got a list of research articles where people say, these things are important, but it's beyond the scope of my study. And I think I can understand that from the perspective of an individual scholar, from an individual study, but as a discipline as a whole, it can't be beyond our scope. It's way too important. And we can study these things now. You know, and these techniques are becoming more easily accessible to all of us. And here I'm getting on my soapbox and proselytizing, but I think without throwing out the good work that's already been done, we can add to it. And with that, I'm going to close. And thank you. First, I want to thank Skip for conceiving of this new format. It's been a lot of work for him. I know it has. You know, that's the no good deed goes unpunished. And I think the fact that he's willing to stick it out says a lot for him. I'd like to thank my co-authors, especially John Alford and Kevin Smith, but also a lot of graduate students who I've worked with through the years. And I'd like to thank you for coming.
I'd like to come to you first. Perhaps you can introduce yourself.
I just opened my PhD from Simon Fraser University in Canada, and I'm originally from East Europe. My accent is Hungarian, was born in Romania, so I have a question that probably reflects my particular view. Your associations were established for the particular United States political arena. And I'm wondering whether you can predict anything for other type of political arenas, for the US setting, where there is a great Labour Party, for France, for Germany. So these correlations work with US liberals and US conservatives. But when the political arena is structured in other ways, I'm curious whether you have a prediction for those settings. Thank you.
No, thank you. Great question. Ralph Waldo Emerson has a great quote that is something like, the two parties which divide the state, the party of innovation and the party of tradition, have been present since the origins of the world and have divided politics everywhere. And I really believe that's true. So in other words, I think if you view politics in terms of the difference between people who are really oriented toward traditional kinds of things, a lack of change, as opposed to people who are welcoming to change. And I think this happens everywhere. In fact, these studies have been done in lots of different countries. I'm not sure about Hungary, but in several countries of Eastern Europe, Italy, UK, not so much in Asia. But it's broadening out, and the techniques are a little bit different, but the basic findings are the same. With regard to social kinds of attitudes, you know, I mentioned gay marriage, things like that. There you see the relationship, and I don't think there's any reason to believe that would be different from country to country. Now, the economic structures are different, and one of the things we're focused on now is to see the, you know, what kinds of, let me put it differently. I mean, one of my major curiosities right now is the extent to which economic attitudes are real and are different than social attitudes. Usually we have these two different dimensions, economic and social. But to a certain extent, you know, the social, I think, intrudes into the economic a lot. I've got some good Danish colleagues, and a few of them are here today, and I remember speaking with them once about, you know, they made the point that the welfare state has been accepted by pretty much all the parties of Denmark, even those on the far right. But then we said, well, what about extending the welfare, the social welfare net to recent immigrants? And he said, oh, no, there we get the big differences of opinion. So now, is that a social issue or is that an economic issue? I mean, that's what I mean about, in many cases, I think the social intrudes onto the economic. And I'd like to know, you know, I'd like to kind of take the social out and then look at the pure economic attitudes. And then I think you'd find probably much less correlation between these kinds of attitudes toward disgust and negativity than you would. In fact, there's some studies of Poland that show people who are more desirous of closure are actually supportive of communist systems. So the left wing, but that makes sense, I think, because they would be used to that. So the traditional, you know, that's what they've grown up with. So if you view it that way, then I think you can see a lot of advantages to transporting this to any country of the world, really. I think politics are less different around the world in the vein of Emerson than we might let on.
My next question.
David Edwards, University of Texas. I'm curious as to whether you pursued your research in the direction of action beyond attitudes, and if so, what you're finding.
What do you have in mind?
Well, what sort of patterns of participation and particular types of participation, or participation or non-participation,
right.
Activism?
Good. Thank you. Yeah. You know, one thing that might interest you is that we have been focusing recently on who participates in politics and who doesn't, regardless of whether they're on the left or the right. We didn't find a real strong correlation with regard to some of the things I told you about today, disgust sensitivity. But we are doing some endocrine studies where we measure people's cortisol levels, which is a stress hormone, and those people who have high cortisol levels are much less likely to vote. And this is actual voting. We got the records from the Secretary of State, which we think is kind of interesting and might have some possibilities. So the argument would be that people who have these, have what you might call a low stress threshold, they're fairly easily stressed out. If they're like that, then why would they really want to plunge full bore into politics, which is really a stressful kind of endeavor in many respects? I don't know if that's the right interpretation, but we did find that nice initial correlation between levels of cortisol and participation in politics. And we're interested in extremity as well. In fact, we just have a grant proposal in with the military. We passed the first round, so they're very eager to know the kinds of physiological signatures that might be present for those people who are so intensely feeling about politics, they might be moved to intolerance or even violence. So hopefully in another year or two, I can tell you more about that. But it does look like there's some endocrinological differences between activists and inert people.
My next question.
Hi, my name is Perry Schwartzschild from the University of Utah. And I guess you painted a picture of traditional political science in terms of demographics as a thin portrait. And I do agree with that. But instead of going down into the genetic level, one could go in another direction towards history and context to get that thicker vision of human nature. I wonder if you ever read the book called The Civilizing Process about by Elias that takes that more historical view towards ideas about disgust. And so a book I wonder if you've read is Every 12 Seconds by Timothy Patcherat, and he goes into a slaughterhouse and does an undercover ethnography. And then later in the book he theorizes this in terms of how we've structured our society in terms of zones of confinement versus zones of privilege. And to me this seems more political, right? The people who are in the zones of privilege are the more powerful. The people in the zones of confinement who are doing the disgusting work like slaughtering the cattle for the consumers who never see that process tend to be the least powerful among us. So my question, finally, we're probably waiting for a question, has to do with notions of political structure and political power and how you see your work intersecting with those kind of traditional political concerns.
That's a good point. And I guess I would only say that I don't have any trouble with the kinds of distinctions you're making, as long as you let me make distinctions at the individual level. That you know, a lot of people in those same situations respond very differently. So, you know, I hope we could both, you know, pursue both tracks and think very carefully, as you seem to be doing, about these situational contexts that people are in. But then, you know, I'm really stuck on this notion that people can be in the same situational context, have had the same experiences, and really be quite different in how they respond to those. So hopefully we can bring those two together and be appreciative of these nuances that you discuss, as well as being appreciative of the individual differences.
All right, I'm going to check my head. What do the worlds taste like? I'm heading over this side, right? What did the worms taste like?
I still didn't hear you, Skip.
What the worms that were, what do they taste like?
Oh, they're great. You should really try them.
Next question is from Professor David Mallaby from Brigham Young.
I'm curious about intergenerational transfer of ideology. And I realize you looked at this at the individual level of the person that you were studying, but did you see any patterns in terms of their parents' ideology? And if so, were there people in the outlying cells whose parents were of one predisposition, but they were of a different predisposition, and how common was that?
Yeah, no, I wish I could answer that, but we have not done the kind of pedigree of this. I think that would be fascinating, especially to do a pedigree of these differences in physiological response as well, not just their political attitudes. But, you know, I don't think we have very good data intergenerationally anyway. I mean, the Jennings and Nimi data set is fantastic, but beyond that, there aren't a lot of those intergenerational things. But
did you even ask a self-report question of what their parents were as you were interacting with them?
You know, one of my former PhD students, so I guess not mine technically, I was on her committee, Amanda Balzer has done some intergenerational work. She's now at IUPUI. So yeah, there's some interest in that. You know, I think one of the things, I don't think this is exactly where you're going with your question, but let me mention it quickly before we move on. I think the intergenerational thing gets confusing because issues change so much. And there again, we're kind of back at a different level. So whereas, you know, 50, 60 years ago, the issue was interracial marriage. And, you know, today maybe it's gay marriage, and that's not gonna be around for very long the way the polls are going. So you know, 50 years it'll be something different. But the idea is that you still see these patterns, and I would suspect that this would hold up intergenerationally, that the ones who were, you know, kind of conservative on interracial marriage were also, would be the ones who are conservative on these issues. So the issues change, issues of the day, but these kind of basic orientations toward bedrock principles such as change and stability would not.
Question.
I didn't actually swallow the worm, Skip.
Hi, Matt Skousen from Franklin Marshall College. I was curious about whether you would see a change over time in terms of age when you're looking at the relationship between self-reporting and then the skin conductance. That is, I would think that over time they might come closer together. I was wondering if that's true or not.
I don't know. That's a great question. Yeah, you know what? In fact, we should do more. So we just thought it was neat that there wasn't a very strong correlation there. But I think your notion is a really good one. We should go beyond that and say, under what situations are people matching up? Do their self-report match up, and where doesn't it? And yeah, whether it moves, again, we don't have longitudinal data that would be appropriate. But there are some interesting things that happen as you move through life. And one of the things that kind of encourages me in my line of thinking is that identical twins tend to become more similar in their political beliefs in lots of other ways as they get older. And so these are twins who don't live together any longer, but it's kind of like, you know, it's almost like that old line about you becoming your father, you know, eventually, or your mother. You kind of get dragged back to that, to what you are at the core. And I think, I don't see how that could happen unless there weren't some of these deeper predispositions.
Next question.
Hi, Jonathan Chapman. I'm a graduate student at Caltech. I was wondering if you could say a little more about maybe the mechanism through which disgust might affect your political attitudes. So is it that you maybe seek out different life experiences or have different information, or is it directly related to how you respond to people?
Right. Well, I guess the basic idea is that if you are disgust sensitive, whether it be physiological or self-report, that you're going to kind of do what you can to put yourself in positions where you wouldn't be disgusted. And one of the ways to do this would be through political action. So, you know, or to broaden it out, not just focus on disgust, but a general aversion to negative things. You know, it seems to make sense then to advocate policies that would reduce the chances you'd be exposed to something negative. So maybe you would advocate stand your ground laws because you want to be able to fight off a bad guy with a gun, more defense spending, capital punishment, all these things that you believe are going to kind of reduce the number of unpleasant experiences that you have. So I don't know if that's exactly what you meant, but I guess that's...
What I was wondering, I guess in some ways, is you could think of another way in which you're disgust sensitive. So you go and choose media outlets which give you a lot of information that makes you think this is disgust sensitive, and that would still make you think, if I expose you to different ideas and sort of a more balanced, you know, range of views, I could still change my mind, as opposed to if it directly, you know, influences how I perceive the world.
Yeah, you know, I think it's important to remember that sometimes we've gotten in trouble because conservatives will claim that we're saying that they're chicken, that they're just scared of things. And that's where I think the kind of traditional division between aversion and approach, or avoidance and approach, rather, doesn't capture everything, because the way I see it, conservatives are likely to attend to negative things. You know, they don't just start running around in a fearful way, but they're paying close attention. So in that sense, I don't think they're just doing everything they can to not be exposed to that. In fact, there's some neuroimaging results that suggest some activation in the dopamine reward system conservatives are experiencing when they're looking at negative things. So, you know, that's not quite sure what that means, except, you know, it's not, the dopamine reward system shouldn't be firing if you're really very bothered by that. It's almost like an interest in it. All I'm saying is there are lots of ways this could play out, and I think the neuroimaging stuff might help us there. We're in the middle of an imaging project right now, and one of the big differences we see between liberals and conservatives when we show them pictures of negative images as opposed to neutral images is that conservatives have activation in parts of the brain, medial prefrontal cortex, which could be interpreted, lots of things this does, but one possibility is that they're kind of tamping down those feelings. Amygdala and insula reaction are the same in liberals and conservatives, which I think is interesting. So the impulse is there when you see that. But what do you do with that? And there's this tamping down that we see in conservatives, whereas with liberals, we see a little bit more activation in the somatosensory cortex, the second part, which is sometimes viewed as a pain region of the brain. So, you know, if I kick you in the shins, S2 would be activated. But also, if you would see me kicking somebody else, your S2 would be activated, but especially if you were liberal. So I always think of Bill Clinton's "and feel your pain" line with that. And there do seem to be some differences between liberals and conservatives with regard to that. So I'm rambling a little bit, but I do think the neuroimaging aspect could be revealing of some of the questions that you're quite rightly asking.
Time for one more question.
Come over here.
Just in the University of Kiel, I was wondering, do you have any plans on following through with this research to the genetic, genomic, or epigenetic level? Because everything I hear seems to suggest that there was a genetic basis for this, that there was a reason during evolution why it should be this gas sensitive to different degree, and why this carries over into current global attitudes and orientation. Do you see a prospect for doing this, the way prices are coming down for genome sequencing, and given that it's very likely that a number of gene region SNPs are going to be involved in behavioral traits like this?
Yeah, excellent question. 2 points. First of all, you know, just a reminder that even though we think genetics is relevant, we think that there are lots of other physical aspects of this that don't have to be genetic. One of my favorite studies is the Maguire study of London taxi drivers, and they show that you can see biological differences in the shape of the hippocampus the longer those guys usually have driven a taxi. So the idea is that the demands of directionality and memory that take place in negotiating a very complicated city change the physical contours of the brain. So, you know, I think that's just one illustration of the fact that it doesn't have to be genetic. Having said that, you know, I do think genetics are relevant. To be honest, our lab has moved a little bit away from candidate gene association studies. I'm glad other people are doing them. But, you know, perhaps implicit in your question is the fact that there are tremendous complications, interaction of genes and the environment, interaction of genes with other genes. You mentioned epigenetics, which increasingly looks to be heritable, by the way, at least in a few generations. But the way these things interact, I think it's going to take a while for those to be sorted out. So we've really moved more toward this physiological kind of middle ground. And that means we punt a little bit on whether that physiological state has been created purely by genetics or purely by the environment or some combination of the two. But we think it's still, you know, really crucial to understand and to demonstrate the extent to which those physiological conditions then can impact our political beings.
All right, so this is clearly an extraordinary research agenda that's putting important substantive and methodological things on the table with huge implications. It's one of the many ways in which our discipline is really moving forward. So, John, I want to thank you for bringing that to us. For all of you, I'd like to thank you for coming here and being part of us. Again, part of this. This is a new thing that we're trying for the Midwest, trying to create these moments or these venues where you can really think about ideas you have the opportunity to. Speaker and so forth. If this is something that you'd like to see more of this association doing, please let us know. You can tell people out in the hallway if you want to, but you can also contact the Midwest or me personally, because it's just, this is, you know, should we be doing more of this? You can sense my view. But I'd really like to know yours. And so at this time, I'd like to thank Professor John Hibbing for a great clip.